Here with boxing star Boyd Melson. He's about to headline and fight for a title. Let's talk about the fight. Big news. When
absolutely.
Is the fight?
It's April 16th, was just told. I don't know who else is going to be on the card. I'm guessing it's going to be pretty big because I'm fighting a 10-rounder and they're going to have me as the first televised bout of the night. So it's a DiBella card. I'm guessing they're going to have some big dogs on it, which makes me pretty excited as well.
You're fighting for a belt?
NABF, I was told. I guess nothing's official until it's signed. But NABF against Charlie Oda. Charlie Oda's 24-2. Charlie Oda is ex-Navy, which makes it pretty neat.
And you're ex-Army, yeah.
Well, I'm still in the reserves, so.
Oh, okay, so you're Army against...
Army reserves, yeah. I already let, on our Facebook page from West Point, I let everybody know this may be going down. They're getting real excited.
But we might have more fights in the stands than the one fight in the ring.
Well, I don't know how deep he's going to roll, because he lives out in Japan. He served out there in the Navy and decided to stay out there after he got out of the Navy. And I thank you for your service, Charlie.
I met Charlie. He's a good dude. I met him up in Big Bear. He was training. And how excited are you to fight and be on TV and fight for the title?
My bucket. A title. And I don't know if I'm a star, but thank you for sharing, for labeling me as that. And I'm not a boxing star, but thank you for labeling me as that. My bucket list for boxing professionally was a 10-rounder, a title fight, nationally televised. And I'm going to get them all on this. And Ron Rizzo, Lou's VP from DiBella, said that I put it out there. I said, what do you think about putting this up at West Point? He said, if it can happen, why not? So I made a call over to the coach at West Point today. He told me the route to try to go is going to be kind of tough. They've never had professional boxing up there. He said maybe opening up Pandora's Box, where if they allow you to do it, what's going to stop them from allowing other promoters to try to do bouts up there? But it is the military, and they may make a decision and say, screw you to everyone else, and you can't say anything. I have a link to a General Dempsey. General Dempsey is a 4-star general, Army West Point grad, and he's the chief of staff of the whole armed forces. And my buddy Nick Abu Daoud, who was my boss when I worked for J&J, his wife's father graduated from West Point, the same class as Dempsey, and is friends with him. So my coach from West Point said,
you're gonna try to make it happen.
Your best bet is to try to get something from up high saying we want this, but if it doesn't happen, it doesn't. I still get those other three, and it's pretty amazing. My classmates come out full force.
So. But not only that, but think about it. I watch, let's say, other sports, and you see the Army, the Navy, Air Force, they spend hundreds, if not millions of dollars in advertising. Here they could get all this for free. Just like, so they might allow you just because it's a great story.
It's a great story.
They might get a million new recruits off this, just for that.
Absolutely. It sure would be excellent. And they have nothing competing April 16th sports-wise up there. So I'm praying. We'll see. I'm still praying that this actually goes through. Like it said, from what I was told, Otis people said yes, at least to competing against me. I don't know if they're willing to do it up there, but we'll see. And then who knows who the main event's going to be. Maybe they want to do it closer to where his hometown is. So I don't know those specifics. I just know April 16th. I thought I was done. I hurt myself against Tapia and the shoulder's feeling better. And like Rocky VI, I still got some stuff in the basement. And we'll see. If this is how I go out, I'm going out with a bang. If something more comes from this, we'll see, but I'm going to be living a little bit of a dream in boxing.
Absolutely. We're here at the WBC convention. You're getting a big award. Tell us about that. Why are they giving you this award for those who didn't watch the piece they did on you on HBO?
The Ambassador of Peace is the name of the award, the WBC Ambassador of Peace. And it touching on the WBC's, WBC Cares for Humanity, which is their 501c3 nonprofit side, trying to help change this world one punch at a time in every aspect they can. People who are underprivileged, children underprivileged, people with disease, people sick, everything. And Jill Diamond is the president of WBC Cares. She lives a few blocks from me in Manhattan as well. She trains at my gym sometimes. And she's taken me in as I'm her child. And she's a big supporter. She came, we had our second annual Fighting for the Cure Gala this last October. And Jill came and brought Jose Suleiman's son, a nephew, to come. And that's when they presented me with this. Demetrius Andrade showed up for that with us.
He's a great
very
dude.
Close brother. Right before Thanksgiving, he had arranged 300 turkeys.
I saw the video. I put it up.
Yeah, I went on out and helped him out. And he's just, I've been telling everyone that Joker's the future of boxing. He just needs his break. It's funny. It's amazing. You could be a world champion in this sport, and still people don't know you. Still people, you still need a break. that break to come. So I believe he'll get it, and it's a matter of time.
But one thing, boy, if you could share with people, your ex-girlfriend. Mm-hmm. Tell us the story for people who are watching this video for the first time who have never met you.
How much time do we have?
Well, I just got here. You have a flight back to New York, so...
Yeah, so at the end of my junior year at West Point, it's called your cow year. They called your cow year because it used to be back in the day, you weren't allowed to go home until junior year, Christmas time, your first time junior year at West Point, you could leave to go home. So they would say, not till the cows come home. So they cut your cow year. I just finished some training I had. I was down in D.C. doing some training for the summer because we do our military training during the summer. And I went home and went out. Whenever I'd come home, always my friends would all get together because I was home so rarely. Went out to this dance club. It's called the Thirsty Turtle. It's up in White Plains. And I saw a girl going through the crowd. And I didn't get to see her so much. I just saw a little arc around her because they had some space and she's in her chair. And it was her. Turned out to be her sister's 21st birthday being celebrated. And I looked at her from behind and being who I guess the knucklehead I was like, and she hates when I say this. Like, man, I bet nobody dances with that girl over there. Let me go over and dance with her. And I went over and I got blocked right off the bat by one of her friends, as females do. And she said, where are you going? Her
better friend, defense than Mayweather.
Girls roll deep. They stay in that shell. And then she said, "She said, where are you going?" I said, "I want to dance with your friend." And she said, "You can't." And I said, "Why?" And she said, "Because you can't." And I said, "Well, may I ask her?" And then she looked down at Kristen, and Kristen looked up and shook her head like that. And I squatted down. It was the first time I saw her face. And I was blown away at this little thing's beauty. And we started talking at night. And I actually teased her a little bit because she lied about her age. And then when she told me how long ago she dove into a 10-foot pool. When she was 10, she dove into a 5-foot pool and broke her neck. I was paralyzed from 10. Now she's 31. She'll be 32 in February. And when she told me, did the math, it turned out she would, according to what her age that she lied to me about, she would have been 16, I think, when it happened. And I remember, she kept speaking, and then I stayed on. I said, wait a second. You were 16 and you don't do a 5-foot pool? And she said, yeah. And I said, stupid are you? What the hell were you thinking? And she started laughing, and that was kind of our relationship off the bat. When I tell people that, they say, are you, how insensitive can you be? I said, screw that, this knucklehead diving in. But so it turned out she was 10. We did the math. Yeah. Figured out her age. She didn't even realize, she told me it was her sister's 21st birthday or something like that, and she would have been 6 months apart from her sister based on the age. And I didn't even put that together. My mother put that together later, and so I called her out. And then we had a deep friendship. It was a little romantic that my last year at West Point, but I was supposed to go to Germany to serve in V Corps in Wiesbaden, and stuff changed. West Point let me stay and help teach freshman boxing after graduation. I went to the All-Army Boxing Camp. I had 3 fights outside of college going to that. I had 18 in college. College was much novice level, and much more novice level. And then I ended up facing this dude who had won the U.S. Nationals the year before, so he was one of the... Do you remember Juan McPherson, that name? He had beat one, and that's how good he was. He beat one, and then that day at All-Army Championships, wasn't better than him, but I guess I was more determined that day, and I got the W, and then I went to the Armed Forces, won that, went to the Olympic Trials with 5 open fights, lost to Ed Joseph, and then I gave Austin Trout a pretty good fight, but I lost him, and that was my 7th fight.
Everyone in the boxing world knows you, from the fighters and trainers.
How?
Because I guess it's a small world. Boxing is a little fishbowl, and everyone sees everybody, whether it's tournaments,
Well, I mean, maybe they don't see my face. I mean,
not only that, like, you're black, you're Jewish, you know, you're from New York. but let's go back. So the girl is in a wheelchair.
And then when we were together, after I found out I was going to go into the Army's program for boxing full-time, Chris, our romance grew, and we became a couple. We were together for 6 years. I took her to China twice. Her dream was to walk again. That's what she told me. And she missed grades 6 through 8, but still finished high school on time. At that time, she was in college, and she was doing hours and hours of physical therapy a day. And that just called on my ethos. And I was like, damn, I'm down. You're down. Let's go try to make this happen. And took her to China twice for 2 experimental stem cell procedures. Took her to Jordan once. Took her to Mexico once. The ones in Jordan and Mexico were actually sham. They weren't what they said. Lost thousands of dollars. Lost the most important hope at those times, at least. And that's how the story went. Then when I was an amateur, since I was successful, I was on the U.S. Team USA for my three and a half years of fighting with them. Because the way I look, I was always getting interviews, and who's this dude that doesn't look like he belongs? So I use that as an example.
Like Shane Mosley yesterday.
Yeah.
Shane Mosley, you're a middleweight.
Yeah, he said that to me. But he said 47 pounder. I was like, I get to chop my leg off. I got big legs. It's hard to get down. And
but one thing about you, Boyd, and you're very humble. But how many, 13, 14, 15 professional fights at this point?
16. 16.
Every dollar you make from boxing, 100% you donate to charity to help find a cure so she could walk. You don't keep anything for yourself. That's crazy.
Right. I donated to, there's a clinical trial that finally, after all these years of me talking about it, the Dr. Wise Young, who's Christopher Reeve's advisor, who's Christopher Reeve's advisor, Superman, when Christopher Reeve had broken his neck, and Dr. Young did this trial in China, flew American physicians on out there to learn how to do it, taking stem cells donated from the umbilical cord after the babies were born. So nothing to do with babies, embryos, nothing. After the babies were born, the family's donated, and he's injecting them straight into the spinal cord. He did the study in China already, and 15 out of the 20 people paralyzed average of 7 years, and one of them 19 years, three of them from the neck down, are now with a walker, able to walk like this.
No way. No way. But
like this.
But and they're moving on their own.
And seven, that's completely paralyzed. So when Paul Williams came to town, we linked up. He came in a few weeks ago.
He's a great dude, by the way. Great dude.
He's the best. I text him all the time. I texted him the other day because you saw those gloves they were selling with the fighters. Yeah, yeah, and they had the Paul Williams. I took a picture and I texted him. He goes, what? We got to get that out of there. I said, listen, champ. I asked him if they knew that you knew this was here. And they said no. But they had all champions on there. It wasn't just, so don't worry. And then I took him to meet Dr. Wise Young with another fighter named Gary Belletto. You ever heard of Gary? He was on The Contender. He was 31-3 the second season. Gary's paralyzed now because Gary was a gymnast growing up, and his son at 7 years old did 20-something pull-ups, so Gary went to go outdo him, and then Gary started doing loops around on the pull-up bar. The bar gave out. He dropped straight on, broke his neck. So I brought them both up there. They got the presentation, and from Paul's mouth when we were done, he goes, you know, man, he saw the videos of the people walking. He saw the images of the spinal cord and the nerves growing through. He goes, man, all this time I'm just hearing all these doctors telling me, like, you're never going to walk. You're never going to walk. And, man, it's a lie. It's a lie. I'm seeing it with my own eyes. I saw the cord growing through. I saw them. You can't tell me it's not possible. All I needed was hope. That's all I needed. And I got in touch with Paul because my best friend, Tom Belukas, Thomas Belukas, he's a firefighter. He hit Corey Robinson, who's Paul's brother-in-law, up on Instagram, and Paul started showing his pictures and said, yeah, I have a friend he should speak to, and now Paul and I, like, once a week we're talking, and the big thing we're going to be launching, you know how they got ALS Ice Water Bucket Challenge?
Yep.
So, did I tell you this already?
No, but I'm excited because I'm going to help you. Whatever you do, you let me know.
This is big, ready?
Okay.
January 5th, we're going to launch Push-Ups for Paralysis, where you say, for Team Fight to Walk, my name is so-and-so. I'm pushing, and you can name someone who's paralyzed. People, you can say, I'm pushing for those paralyzed fighting to walk. I'm banging out or doing X amount of push-ups. You bang them out. You call out who you want.
You know why I'm laughing, boy?
Why?
Because I owe thousands of push-ups all over Los Angeles. I'm going to be the king of this thing.
That's how you bet people push. That's how my friends want to bet money. Now I'll bet you some push-ups.
I owe Brandon Krause a few hundred. He's a trainer in L.A. I owe another trainer.
Good. So you can put a dollar on each of those. Because, listen, for every push-up short you fall, who challenges you, you got to give a dollar.
Okay.
Plus 10. So if you do the amount or more, you do 10. So I've become friends with Anthony Mason from the Knicks. He said he's going to help. Paul's going to help. Paul can do him on his knee like that, but we want to make it look better. We can lift him up and have him bang him out. Gary Belletto's going to do it. Gary broke his neck. Gary just sent me a text. On his knees, he did 41 push-ups. This Joker was paralyzed from his neck down for some time. Demetrius Andre said he's on. Spoke to Marcus Brown. He said he's down. And the big kicker, and Eric LeGrand from Rutgers.
Yeah.
He's got a huge web. The whole thing is just the right webs. You put it on out to at the right time. So I'm going to challenge my whole West Point class, and they have their web. And then the Army, but current Army boxing team, the WCAP boxing team, challenged Eric. And Eric was like, man, you can't challenge. I can't do it right now. And I said, well, that means you got to give all the money. And then I said, well, you just say you'll save them for when you are able to do them. And Paul at the tournament said, he said he'll speak to Sylvia and Al from Al Haymon and get all the fighters on. Their webs, we need to raise $5.5 million by this summer because it should be starting this July where they recruit hospitals in New York and New Jersey. And doctors also, he's also doing it in India, Norway, and China at the same time because in science, you have to be able to repeat the results so they make sure it just wasn't a random chance. So you do them in different countries where they're not related to anything in the other one. As far as what, like no bias or anything, bias, I don't know, something like that. So I said, get them on. You get just a couple of people, the right people. You got to raise $5.5 million. You get 500,000 people to do $10 each. And 500,000 is not a lot. We're talking about these Mayweathers and the Grands that have all these people.
Justin Bieber and everybody.
Yeah.
But I'm serious.
You're right.
He comes to a boxing gym near my house, and he's friends with Floyd.
Triple H.
And Triple H, but I gotta ask you this. If people are watching this and they want to be involved, what's the website that they go if they want to donate, if they want
to
help?
Teamfight2walk.com. Every word spelled out. Team and then T-O and fight to another T-O, walk.com.
Team fight to walk.
And we donate everything to this clinical trial because they're raising all the funds publicly, and that's what I've been donating my purses to. Other side note, so tomorrow I'm going to be receiving the first draft of the script written on my story to try to make into a movie. I'm on a mission to get in touch with Drake because that's why I want to play me, because Drake's black, white, and Jewish. So I think he would jump at it. The guy who wrote that has written the Arturo Gatti movie as well. It's called Can You Hear the Thunder? Thunder Gatti. It's on IMDb. They just gave the script to John Leguizamo to look at to see if he'll play Gatti. And I think they're going to approach Cuba to see if it'll be Buddy McGirt. And right now, this knucklehead may be playing Mickey Ward in the movie.
Hopefully, man, that'd be sick.
I told him, I said, listen, it's going to be, you pay me less than whatever you have to pay someone else. I'm donating whatever you give me, and you're going to have, I have a little bit of a following, and you don't want him to overshadow Gatti with whoever Leguizamo, if he protects it or not. You don't want him comparing it to Wahlberg. You want, like, a nobody. And I said, is the boxing more important than the acting? He goes, the boxing, I want round 9 of the first fight, punch for punch, the same.
Can you hit in the body like you, like?
I said, well, for TV, I can. I said, this is all, if I got to do war, this is all. Ready? a couple of these and be tough. So, hopefully April, he said that's going to be shooting. They got ICM on board and they have like $2.2 million promised right now. And I'm praying it goes big. So, these are some exciting things happening here. But I really, this push up for paralysis challenge. I mean, we're starting in January. Got all people the resolutions. ALS was 2014 and now... Just the right couple of people blasting this on out could help change the world.
Absolutely. I gotta ask you this, though. Since being a boxer is a 24-hour job, 365, the way you eat, the way you live, you're donating everything to charity. How do you live?
So I'm a captain in the Army Reserves. That's 1 weekend a month. I have a regular job, medical device sales, where you're in the operating room with a device that the clinicians, the doctors, and the nurses are using. And you sell it to them, and then get them to use it. So I'm in the hospital doing that. And it's funny, you know, it's interesting. Like, I'll deal with some. A lot of times you get this egocentrism in the world where what people are doing, they forget there's a whole world outside going on. And it kind of helps that I have this greater purpose in the military as well to think of. Because when I'm inside the OR, and they don't know me from anybody, and they just be nasty to me, these nurses or these doctors or whatever, it's so easy to roll over. So I'm like, dude, I know this is the most important thing in your life right now, or it's so important that you want to be an a-hole to me and you don't know me, and that's fine, that's your choice, but there are much greater things going on right now. And the universe, if you're having a bad day and you want to be me, you probably have some other bad things going on in your life that you have to worry about that I'm not concerned about. I'm going to smile, whatever. You're not taking my sunshine. And it helps me stay focused. And also, one of the things, like people don't realize how incredible our spirits are as boxers. Like when they said, how can you handle the pressure if something's happening in the OR? How can you? I'm like, man, you ever had to lose 10 pounds in a day? You tell me, you ever had some heat on you when you're in that ring and you're dying, someone's trying to kill you? You think this is tough? Come on now. You know, we can do anything. Talking about excelling during combat when the stakes are the highest, when you actually may think you're going to die. And you think I'm nervous because I'm in here and someone tell me they don't want to use your product or get the hell away from me or whatever. It's just a jab, that's all it is.
You know, John McCain used to be a boxer. He actually boxed in the Navy with Bert Sugar. Seriously.
I didn't know that. I know he boxed all the Air Force. He went to the Naval Academy, and in all three military academies, you have to take boxing as a gym class freshman year. So I know he at least did that. I didn't know he boxed further.
You or Lou or someone should reach out to him because I think he can make a lot of things happen. You
that's
might fight.
Hell of an idea.
If it's not West Point, it may be the Navy. Naval base, but same principle. And then the Army will say, no, we have competition.
We got to do it here. But if it is there and everyone's rooting against me, that's for you. You, I'm coming out.
It's okay. Look, I got haters. You just. How about this, Boyd? If people want to follow you on Twitter and they're watching this, where do they go?
This is Boyd Melson, B-O-Y-D, and then Melson, M as in Mary, E-L-S-O-N. And I have Facebook, Say Yes to Everybody, send it on through. If you know anybody that has a spinal cord injury and you want some information, my email, it's BAM, BAM, my initials, then the word strong, and then 1981 at Gmail, BAM, strong, 1981, that's my email. I get Facebook messages from people all over the world frequently who are paralyzed and hurt somehow, and they ask me to call them or they Some, I don't know how they get my number sometimes, but they get it, but I don't give a crap, and I give whatever information I can, hope. That's, I don't have any promises for any, only thing I can promise is I'll share what I know and offer hope, but I don't have any promise I'm going to get someone out of a chair. If I had that promise, Kristen would be walking now. You know, wheelchair was really neat yesterday when I got to go up with all the champs, and Oscar was talking to someone when he turned at me, and just the warmth and the smile, he got so excited to see me, and a little nervous of me not remembering him, I fought on his cards, and he was like, man, I'm so proud of you, everything you're doing, and it's just great. And I told him they're making a script about this, and he said, that's incredible. And also, I spoke to Dave Itzkowitz from Rock Nation yesterday, uh-huh. because what I got, Will Evans is his name, who wrote the Gotti script, what his idea is for the premiere, he wants to have it at a match, some venue, show it on the big Jumbotron ahead of time, and then he wants to put on 3 bang-em-out type fights, and he said he'd like me to be one of the fighters on that. So we'll see. So I brought it up to Dave, and Dave said, have him give me an email, and maybe that's all something.
Maybe you never know. I mean,
never know.
It's going to be something, man.
Yeah.
Twitter, at Boyd Melson.
Instagram's Boyd Melson. Twitter, it should be Boyd Melson also. I slack on Twitter, I'm not even going to lie. And my boy Tom, my best friend, he always gets on me about Instagram, so I'm trying more. But Facebook's the best. And then if you need some help with anything, man, if you just want advice for whatever, please call me. You know, I just went to a elementary school. I spoke to 300 fourth and fifth graders.
Wow.
And showed them the HBO, Real Sports Book, and the go-away message. Because it's a lot harder to get people. I think adults give excuses a lot more as to why they may not want to show their heart, or what happens if they do, because they think of other negative experiences. But with kids, I always feel like if adults could have the inner child, the key to peace and everything in this world is letting the inner child come out. Because when you're children, things are simple.
You have no worries.
No worries, right or wrong. You feel it's good, you do it. And the go away message I said to these people, because I said to them, you know, I was dating somebody who was in a wheelchair, and the way I was raised, they're just sitting down. And the thing that matters most is if somebody's kind. And take away that magic. Nobody looks like you. You look like yourself. No one, unless you got cloned or have a twin, look like yourself. So everybody's different. What you judge is if they're kind. And I beat that down. I had one little kid raise his hand. There were 9, 10-year-olds. And I called him in the audience, and he said, I just want you to know, I'm going to West Point. And I said, how do you know about West Point? He said, I went up there for summer camp, and I told my parents. They were not too happy. And he's speaking like an adult. Yeah. And I just had the biggest smile on my face. I said, what do you know about it? He said, well, I have to serve for 9 years. And I said, well, it's 4 years there, 5 years after. He said, yes, I know. It's 4 at the college. And I'm like, man, dude, you're 10 years old. Yeah. It's you. And I told him, I said,
he's focused.
Yeah, very focused. And I remembered when I was that age, I didn't know what West Point was, but my parents would always tell me that's what I would say, and I'd get freaky looks from people. And then there was a time when I didn't want to go there, when I learned more about it, but then it changed. And I told him, I said, it's tough because you're your age, and right now you're young, and tomorrow is a big day coming up in your life. Because every day when you're little, the next day, you haven't been alive that long. And I said, as you get older, there may be times when you realize it's not for you. There may be challenges. There may be people telling you not to do it. And maybe it won't be for you. But if you want it, remember right now I'm talking to you, little fifth grader. Remember this. I did it. If I'm doing something now that you want to try to do one day, it exists. Just don't let anybody tell you no unless you don't want it. And I love talking to these little kids.
There you have it, Boyd Melson. He has to fly back to NY. His flight's leaving any minute. EsNews.com. I'm Melissa, back reporting.